You're listening to the audio production of Desired by God. Discover a strong, soul-satisfying relationship with God by understanding who He is and how much He loves you. By Van Moody, with Susie Florey. Published by Thomas Nelson and read by Barry Scott. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit info.thomasnelson.com/desiredbygod.
Prologue. A love story. Love is all. It gives all. And it takes all. Søren Kierkegaard. Once upon a time, a young man fell in love with a young woman. To him, she was the most beautiful, intelligent, and wonderful person he'd ever met. She looked like an exquisite blossom from the garden. She smelled like a fresh spring rain. Her voice sounded like the tinkling bells of a fine music box. And he could not stop thinking about her. What is she doing right now? He wondered every waking moment of every single day. What is she thinking? Who is she with? Does she miss me as much as I miss her? Does she love me as much as I love her? I wonder if, right now, she might just be thinking of me. The man liked to write, and since he was more comfortable putting his feelings down on paper than speaking them out loud, he began to write her letters to pour out his feelings. "I am only yours," he wrote, "eternally yours." In another letter, he tried to describe his unquenchable feelings. "In the stillness of midnight, for the day does begin at midnight, and at midnight I awoke, and the hours grew long for me, for what is as swift as love? Love is the swiftest of all, swifter than itself." He felt his love growing quickly, and the thought frightened him. He wasn't sure he knew what love was, or how to love a woman the way she deserved to be loved. The man was the youngest of 7 children born into a strict house with a melancholy father who was stern and religious. With so little joy and lightness in the house, he felt like he'd been born old as a child, and later as an adolescent. He liked school, loved to learn, and enjoyed his studies, although he wasn't part of the popular crowd. Instead, he tried to impress others with his wit. As a university student, he made mistakes and ended up with some debts, which his father paid. When he finally buckled down to concentrate on his studies, he decided to become a pastor. The opportunity to spend much of his time in intensive study, along with the steady nature of the job, appealed to him. But when he was about to enter seminary, the most beautiful girl he'd ever seen came into his life and changed everything. The young woman became fond of him, too, and they spent some time together. As their love grew, so did his spirits. "In all of this, I am happy, indescribably happy, for I know what I possess. And when it storms and roars in the workshop of my thoughts, I listen for your voice," he wrote. As his relationship continued, he found he could no longer contain his feelings. He was deeply in love and wanted to be with her every moment of every day. In one of his letters, he wrote down his most fervent, passionate wish that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor the present, nor that which is to come, nor the exalted, nor the profound, nor any other creature may tear me from you or you from me. He was a man in love, and it consumed him from the moment he woke to the moment he closed his eyes at night. His life revolved around her, and he thought of nothing else. The love-struck man was Søren Kierkegaard, a famous Danish philosopher, and the woman he loved with all his heart was named Regine Olsen. Their love story is a famous one, and Søren put down many of his feelings in his letters both to her and to a close friend. Have you ever experienced a feeling of love like Søren's? where your whole life revolved around another person and your feelings for him or her. Love is the most powerful and consuming emotion on the planet, and the feeling can be so strong that you feel overwhelmed with the intensity of it. You are overcome with the desire to love and be loved. To be love-struck means to be passionately consumed with someone or something, impacting your life. Your thoughts, emotions, and actions are locked on the object of your love. You can feel this not only for a romantic partner, but also for your children, your pets, and even sometimes a pastor, politician, athlete, or entertainer. Sometimes, the feeling of being in love is intensified when that love is not returned. Think about the political hangover and heartache many people feel after a major election when it becomes very difficult for them to understand why other people aren't in love with their candidates or their particular visions of America. One of my favorite poems about that feeling is I Wrote a Good Omelet by Nikki Giovanni. It talks about falling in love and feeling upside down and topsy-turvy, with the poet describing how she can't even tell the difference between a poem and an omelet anymore. Have you ever felt that way? Your mind and heart are with someone else. Your emotions and thoughts invested in a relationship where your feelings may or may not be completely reciprocated. Doesn't matter if you're single or married. If you have been around for any period of time and in any sort of relationship, you know what it feels like to be unabashedly in love. It can be beautiful and wonderful and earth-shaking, but it can also be difficult and uncomfortable if the two of you are not in the same exact emotional place. It can be heart-wrenching if you are the one who is more deeply and emotionally invested. You're yearning for the love of another, and it can hurt. Yet this is how God made us. God Himself desires to love and be loved. We're created in His image, so it's in our DNA to desire to love and be loved. We have the same yearnings for connection with another being that He has, and the same potential for love that He does. In the book of Ezekiel, God describes His love for the people of Israel in chapter 16 as if He were talking about a young woman. He freely lavishes her with gifts to enhance her beauty and show His love. I clothe you with an embroidered dress and put sandals of fine leather on you. I dressed you in fine linen and covered you with costly garments. I adorned you with jewelry. I put bracelets on your arms and a necklace around your neck, and I put a ring on your nose, earrings on your ears, and a beautiful crown on your head. As a lover, God paints a word picture of a woman given the best of the best to set her apart as special and adored. So, you were adorned with gold and silver. Your clothes were of fine linen and costly fabric and embroidered cloth. Your food was honey, olive oil, and the finest flour. You became very beautiful and rose to be a queen. And your fame spread among the nations on account of your beauty, because the splendor I had given you made your beauty perfect, said God. Verses 10 through 14. After these passionate descriptions of the woman He loves, God declares His love for her with a wedding vow. I gave you my solemn oath and entered into a covenant with you, declares the Sovereign Lord, and you became mine. Verse 8. He loves her so much, He wants her to be His forever. It's as if He were signing a letter exactly the way Soren did. I am yours, eternally yours. In the Old Testament love poem called Song of Songs, God again takes on the persona of a man in love. First, the woman hears a knock. I slept, but my heart was awake. Listen, my beloved is knocking. Open to me, my sister, my darling, my dove, my flawless one, he says through the door. Chapter 5, verse 2. That man at the door is God, calling and knocking on the door of your life because he yearns for a relationship with you. Just as Soren was in love with Regine, pouring out his heart on the page in pen and ink, so God was in love with his people, lavishing them with the best of everything he had to offer. And he still is in love with his people, every one of them, including you. Isn't it wonderful? You are always in his mind, and he wants nothing to come between you and him, ever. You are loved and desired by God every day, every minute. Stop and think about that for a moment. Not only are you known by God, but you are desired by God. He loves you, and he wants you close. Sometimes we forget about that, as you'll see in the book ahead. It's important to understand how, even though God loves and relentlessly pursues his people, we often get distracted by life's ups and downs and forget who loves us most. It happened early in human history, and it still happens today. This book is a look at the passionate nature of the God who loves us and explores what it means to understand and embrace that love. We'll also try to make sense of what it means to live in light of that love, with a deep sense of knowing how much God desires us and wants us to return that desire. Unlike the sometimes complicated love affairs of men and women, God never loses control of himself while pursuing his beloved. But he will go to the utmost lengths, even the cross, for those he loves. There is no other love story quite like this one. Introduction. The love story to end all love stories. Love recognizes no barriers. It jumps hurdles, leaps fences, penetrates walls to arrive at its destination full of hope. Maya Angelou. Steve Jobs was a man in love, but unlike Kierkegaard, his intense and passionate and all-consuming love was not focused on a particular person. Instead, it was focused on a product. First, it was a desktop computer. Next, a music storing and playing device. Then, finally, a phone. Steve Jobs loved creating sleek, beautiful, and innovative pieces of technology for our desktops and pockets. People loved him. But why? He's not a hero in the conventional sense. He never led a country or fought a war or defended the innocent. His inventions didn't directly advance the cause of science, save people's lives, or even lengthen them by the way medical innovations can. He didn't explore Earth, sea, or space and add to the body of knowledge about the universe. He never even graduated from college. And apparently, he wasn't even a particularly nice person. Some family members, friends, and employees have stories to tell about how his love for his products often took precedence over his love for those closest to him. By all accounts, Jobs sometimes chose work over love and products over people. But each little machine he had a hand in creating was a wonder, its design and functionality springing from a man who seemed obsessed with putting an Apple device or two into the home of almost every American. He changed the way we communicate, gather, and disseminate information. There's an Apple store in almost every big city, and people still gather for new product launches, camping out on the street for the chance to purchase the latest Apple product. Steve Jobs passed away in 2011, but he's still alive through his products, and the legend of his life and work continues to grow. Yes, he had talent and creativity to spare, but what powered his life and work and innovation was the universe's most powerful emotion, love, for his creations. Jobs said, "You must truly love what you do for a living. If you haven't found it yet, keep looking. Don't settle. As with all matters of the heart.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.